size or comfort level, and are Irish made with a 20-year construction guarantee. The annual Finlime Furniture January sale takes place in our showrooms in Dublin, Cork, Leash, and brand new showrooms now open in Galway. Hugely reduced sale discount prices available for the month of January only. Thousands of fabrics available. See finlinefurniture.ie.
The Football Show on Off the Ball.
Brought to you by Boyle Sports. Now with same-day withdrawals to your Visa debit card.
I'm prepared to end it in my cap.
Well, do it then.
Come play again.
Do it then.
What about your start to the game?
It wasn't bad, was it?
Why should it be an honest answer be a mistake?
How can a modern-day manager not have a mobile phone?
Why should he?
Welcome along to Wednesday's football show. Nathan with you this evening. Kev is in studio as well. It's Southampton 0, Derby 0 in the FA Cup third round replay. There's just over an hour gone. There's been a VAR controversy that we'll get to in a moment. We've got Damian Delaney coming up as well. He is 37, but he's going to play on. He's just signed for Waterford United after a frustrating season at Cork City. We'll talk to him about that and his time at Crystal Palace and really getting the opportunities that he deserved at international level. So that's coming up shortly as well. But Richie has popped in to fill us in on all the live sport.
Yeah, fourth round trip to Accrington Stanley on Saturday week, awaiting the winners of tonight's FA Cup third round replay at St Mary's, where it remains Southampton 0, Derby 0. Derby's Craig Bryson had a goal chalked off by the VAR for an offside in the build-up just prior to half-time. Elsewhere, Leeds manager Marcelo Bielsa says he's had all of their opponents this season watched before they played them. The Argentinian is being investigated by the Football League after admitting sending a member of staff to spy on Derby's training session ahead of last Friday's game at Elland Road. Bielsa says he's not broken the law and he didn't have any bad intentions, and he's also admitted that even though he knows it's not illegal, it means it's the right, it doesn't mean it's the right thing to do.
But
it's hard.
Is he going to continue doing it?
It's not done anything illegal, has he? That's like kind of standard practice.
Not killed the man.
Why were the police called then? Why did they turn up?
Well, because that's like a trespasser, isn't it?
They thought somebody was acting suspiciously around their ground. So
yeah, and when they found out he's like spying, they're like,
let him off.
Yeah.
On you go. Good lad, see you later.
Do you think, will there be a punishment for Leeds? Do you think they'll end up getting deducted points?
I don't, because the FA set a precedent then, aren't they? There's nothing to suggest you can't do it, has it?
Like, what happens if you're walking along by Melwood some afternoon and they think you're spying on Liverpool training for Everton, your former club?
Well, yeah. That's,
and you're arrested.
Who's to say I wouldn't do that?
For lurking in the bushes.
Yeah. So that's not happened before, but
well,
anyway.
Let's not incriminate yourself tonight.
Oh.
Joe Schmidt says Ross Byrne is still very much in his thinking despite the Leinster at half being left out of the 38-man squad for the first two rounds of the Six Nations. Connacht's Jack Carty is preferred to Byrne and is one of three uncapped Connacht players named in the squad today. Joining him, scrum half Quaylen Blade and the centre Tom Farrell. Elsewhere, UCC have gotten their Sigerson Cup campaign off to an impressive start this evening. They ran out a whopping 7-25 to 2-4 winners over Athlone IT, God bless them, at the Marlock tonight. Meanwhile, UL edged out DIT in a scoreline of 113 to 112 at Grange Gorman. And earlier, St Mary's needed a free-taking competition to get the better of NUI Galway. 4-2 in frees after a finish 1-11 apiece after extra time.
Ireland's Nathan Redmond scored.
Has there been any more on that?
Nothing.
No, Mick was talking on Friday night at the Soccer Writers Awards, basically saying it's all ticking along. The negotiations, I think, are happening behind the scenes. We won't know anything till
probably the way it should
probably
be.
Probably the squad is announced.
Yeah, would you take him?
Would I take him?
Yeah.
I think it'd be hypocritical of me to say no. I don't particularly like it.
Yeah.
The very fact he's played for England at senior level, that he has played probably, he's probably pulled on an England jersey 100 times between everything and has never expressed at any stage an interest in playing for Ireland. But he's eligible to play, so therefore we just got to accept it.
You're presuming that Declan Rice plays, he's going to want to win the match that he's involved in.
I don't like it in any way.
It's a bit grubby, and I don't think anybody really.
But it's all a bit grubby.
Yeah, exactly.
International football has become a bit grubby.
It is. The ruling has become a joke, hasn't it? It's farcical now the way that it is. But that I don't know how can you. I don't know how can you. As you say, he's never showed any desire to play for us.
Well, that's the thing. If he had played at underage level, if he'd shown any sort of desire to play at underage level, not only that, he has shown he's played for England at senior level. So he clearly wants to be an England international, and he's been in good form since
Shane Long's
cleared off the line.
Oh,
the rebound.
Great goal, that.
James Ward-Prowse has nodded it in. I think they're going to go to the VAR. No, it's Armstrong.
He's a good player as well. He's done great since coming from Celtic, hasn't he? Mm.
Slightly similar situation in the first half where a ball was played across to Shane Long 5 yards out and he fired it straight at the keeper and the rebound fell to Armstrong. Open goal. And it sort of slid agonisingly.
Well, he couldn't sort his feet out. He couldn't sort his feet, could he? He couldn't adjust his body. He should have scored. It was an absolute sitter for him.
Difficult to do when you're face down with an open goal to sort your feet out, isn't it?
Is it? You tell me.
You tell me, Kev.
No, you tell me. You've got a lot to say on the matter.
I'm just saying it can be difficult to sort your feet out when you're...
No, you've just got a lot to say. Sometimes, you know, they say it full of waffle without anything to back it up.
Listen, we all remember 2002. This time, Long's header is cleared off the line and Armstrong falls from, 2 yards out? And he taps it in, so Southampton are 1-0 up. It's been a decent game, actually.
Yeah, he has. I think they're looking at VAR again.
Why are they looking at VAR?
Yeah, just to cover the tracks. He's not offside. It's actually a great ball from Shane Long holding it up to the floor. I mean, he's never been offside, has he?
Just make the decision yourself, referee.
I know. That's what I... Well, I think, realistically, that one there, that's... It's done. Like, you're delaying a game here. It's only 30 seconds. People say, what's the 30-second delay? But that's clearly, there's no offside. There's no problems there at all with that goal. Just give it and carry on. And, well, thankfully they haven't. Just get on with
it. We should mention that it seems as though your life-size cutout is going to happen. Alan Brogan, former Dublin footballing hero.
The Alan Brogan as well. I kept doubting it earlier.
I'm doubting it can be such a man can produce...
Well, he works for a printing company, Custodian.
There you go.
And they are going to do this. I've sent them a picture of you in your Mayo jersey that we're going to get. I hope we can have it in the studio tomorrow night.
Jones's Road.
And this is going to some guy who's built a little man cave.
Yeah.
And I don't even want to know what they're going to do with it. But he's getting himself a full-size Kilban life-size.
Someone suggested we do an outside broadcast from this man cave down in Kilkenny, and I just want to say I'm fully supportive of this.
How many can fit in there?
Well, but let's find out.
You just need a couple of mics and away you go.
Let's find out.
We got to go to ads, lads. But Darragh Corcoran has been in touch. Kilban should be spying on Liverpool.
It's 2-0. Let's get Nathan Redmond on the plane.
Yeah.
That boy is just after chipping one in.
Great goal.
And made it Southampton 2, Derby 0.
I'm not in favour of another Nathan entering Irish public life. So for that reason alone, I'm out.
Yeah.
Kilban should be spying on Liverpool. He might help Everton close that 27-point gap, says Darragh Corcoran on Twitter. Damien Delaney.
It's going to get shorter.
Football on Off the Ball.
Brought to you by Boyle Sports. Now with same day withdrawals to your Visa debit card. As you know, on Lunchtime Live, we like to rip up the running order and go completely unscripted. And this Friday, we're handing over the reins to you once again. We want you to share your stories and set the agenda on Friday's show. Any topic, any area, from anyone. You have full control for the 2 full hours. Email us your ideas now on lunchtimelive@newstalk.com and have your say.
Lunchtime Live.
And Unscripted.
With Kira Kelly.
Thanks to VideoDoc. This Friday from midday.
On Newstalk.
Planning a getaway in 2019? With rooms from €109 per night, including breakfast, the newly refurbished Metropole Hotel Cork is the perfect choice in the heart of Cork City. Go on and treat yourself and let us at the Metropole Hotel surprise you. Book now at themetropolehotel.ie.
Football Index is reinventing football betting. You can buy and sell the world's top players. Their value may go up and down, but it's not over with the final whistle like a regular bet. Football Index, reinventing football betting.
Start building your portfolio today at footballindex.co.uk or download the app now. New customers only, minimum deposit and conditions apply. Gamble responsibly.
Nissan's latest innovation is the van that never gets old. Buy any 191 Nissan van and replace it with a new van every 3 years from just €49 per week ex-VAT. Plus, get 3 years free motor tax and 3 free services. Visit nissan.ie. Nissan. Innovation that excites. Finance offers for business users only. Finance is provided by AIB Leasing Limited by way of a leasing agreement. Allied Irish Banks PLC and AIB Leasing Limited, trading as AIB Finance and Leasing, are regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland. Eligibility, lending criteria, terms and conditions apply.
Flu season has invaded, and it's time to fight back. Our first mission is to protect people at risk. Everyone over 65, pregnant women, and those with health problems should get the flu vaccine. Next, we need to stop the spread of colds and flu. If you're ill, stay at home, use tissues when you cough or sneeze, and wash your hands frequently. Finally, visit undertheweather.ie for advice on treating the flu and other illnesses at home. Let's stay well. From the HSE.
Shane Byrne here to tell you about the Rugby Legends match at the RDS on February 1st. Join me and an array of Lions, Grand Slam, World Cup winners as we raise funds for rugby-related charities, including My Name Is Doddy Foundation, aiding research into motor neuron disease. It could be your last chance to see some rugby greats like Gordon Darcy, Mick Galway, Mike Tindall, Josh Lucy battle it out on the field. Rugby Legends at the RDS, 7 p.m. February 1st. Tickets available on Ticketmaster.ie. Hashtag Rugby Legends.
Living a busy life and want to avoid colds and flu? When you start feeling run down, reach for Avogel Echinoforce, made from fresh echinacea herb. Avogel Echinoforce is a natural remedy that helps fight colds and flu by strengthening the body's immune system. Avogel Echinoforce, available at health stores and pharmacies nationwide. Always read the leaflet.
GoHop.ie now have the very best fares to North America, thanks to the American Airlines and British Airways big USA sale. From summer, you can fly direct from Dublin to Dallas and explore all that Texas has to offer, or discover all four corners of the US with the best combined network, including Charleston and Nashville. With four cabin choices plus complimentary meals and drinks, it's never been easier to start your own US adventure with American Airlines and British Airways. Plan your next escape to the USA with GoHop.ie.
Off the ball. This is News Talk.
All right, so Damian Delaney is going to extend his career into a 20th season after signing for Waterford United for the upcoming League of Ireland season. Damian is on the line now. Evening, Damian.
Hi, how are things?
37 now, you're going to turn 38 during the League of Ireland season. 2 decades as a pro, there must be some deep love of football that's keeping you going on.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much it, really. I played the game obviously before I turned professional, and you know, for fun and enjoyment and stuff. And obviously, I had my career. And when I finished there in Cork last year, I thought, why should I stop? You know, I still enjoy the game. I still love football. I love everything that goes with it: the training, the tactics, the banter in the changing room, everything. So I didn't really see a reason to stop. And obviously, Rennie phoned me, and when someone wants you, then
yeah.
You know, it just kind of made sense, really.
Yeah, it's great to hear, because like it's only 15, 16 months since you were starting in the Premier League for Crystal Palace at Old Trafford against Manchester United. Like, the RSC in Waterford, in many ways, feels like it's a world away from that. And from your experience of playing with Cork last season, you obviously are still then getting the same buzz as you were getting even 3-4 years ago when you were full-time first-team player at Palace.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that sums it up, you know. Football is always football, and I enjoy it so much. So I didn't really see a reason. Obviously, there's a difference between playing at Old Trafford and playing at the RSC, but ultimately when you strip away everything that goes with it, it's still four white lines and two goals at either end. I still enjoy it, and I didn't see a reason to stop.
Mm. There's something that you said in your first answer there, talking about you still enjoy it though, Damian. We had Keith Tracy on recently, spoke about the fact is that once he turned professional, he rarely, if ever, enjoyed a game of football throughout his career. Where do you get that enjoyment from? And how do you, like what you're saying, 20 years into a professional career now, how do you still have that enjoyment? And what does actually keep you motivated?
I just enjoy it. I love my alarm goes off in the morning, and I get to go training. And you know as well, when you get to go outside and put on a pair of boots for a couple of hours in the morning, I don't see anything else that I would want to do. And I feel I would be cheating myself if I felt I was still able to do it and I didn't do it. Now, obviously, I couldn't do it at the same level that I have done it, and maybe, you know, time will tell how much I can give Waterford, but I still love being in the environment. I love watching. I get a sense of enjoyment when I watch young kids, you know, learning the game, and I see them improve, and they come in at the start of the season, and by the end of the season, they're a different player, and I get a buzz out of that, and I enjoy it, and I like helping people, and that's why I went out to Waterford, you know, to play, obviously, but, you know, I want to help and be a part of that environment, and the success and the drive for success is all part of it.
How's the body? How's that feeling?
Good, really, yeah, which was the main thing, you know. I was fortunate that I managed to leave England relatively intact. A lot of people, you know, of carrying issues and maybe would suffer later in life with certain things. But, you know, I left England and I felt really, really fit. I felt really strong. I wasn't have any injuries, nothing recurring or nothing that I couldn't seem to get rid of. So I felt good, and that's why I come back to Cork. And then when I left Cork last year, you know, I had 2 months off. We finished there early November, and Alan Reynolds was on to me about going down to Waterford, and I said to him, look, Rennie, I need some time off, you know, because, you know, I had a year with Palace at the end. You know, granted, I didn't play that much, but I trained every day for a year. I didn't miss anything, and then I went straight into a Cork City season, and that's tough for a young person, I think, to rattle off 18 months on the spin. I think that caught me a little bit towards the back end of the season at Cork City. I think I did hit a bit of a brick wall, to be honest with you. So once Rennie was phoning me, I said, look, give me some time. You know, I need a break here. I need to go away and let everything settle down and let my mind clear. And then once that happens, I'll be able to make a decision. But in fairness to him, he's persisted. He didn't leave me alone. He kept on at me and on at me and on at me and stuff. And he's quite an infectious character, and he's quite bubbly, so I kind of fed off that a little bit with him, and I liked what he was saying, and I thought, well, yeah, I kind of want to be a part of this, so I phoned him there just after Christmas and started pre-season last week.
How did you find last season with Cork then? Because understandably there was a lot of expectation when you decided to return home, because you were still involved with Crystal Palace right up to that season, that you're coming straight back from the Premier League. How did you find the change to League of Ireland football?
The change was fine. I mean, I love League of Ireland football. That's the other thing. I really do. I really am a fan of the league, and I wish it got better kind of exposure and people believed in it a little bit more. So I felt that coming back, I enjoyed that, and I don't mind that. You know, I know a lot of people leave the environment that I was in, and they can't handle the travelling and the arrangements and the pitches and all this stuff. But none of that stuff bothers me, man. You know, I enjoy that. I love the getting on a bus and, you know, heading up to Dublin, and, you know, maybe the preparation and everything might not be the same, but I've got no issues with that. And ultimately, I came home to play football. So from that side, it was fine. But when I look back, like I said, once I took the 5 or 6 weeks off there over in November, I kind of look back, and I definitely made some mistakes when I came over to Cork. I didn't manage my body. I was too excited, really. You know, I was like a kid going in there, and I didn't miss a minute of training.
Right.
And John runs a tight ship there down in Cork. You know, it's a tough enough environment that he sets there, which is, you know, absolutely fine. You know, John can run how he wants, and maybe I should have spoke to him a little bit more. And just said, look, maybe I need to pull back from this and save myself for games and things. And as I said previously, the having a 12-month stint in the UK and then going straight in and playing pretty much straight away here was too much for me. And I think once I kind of got to September, I definitely felt that I'd hit a brick wall, basically. But mistakes were made on my part, basically, and I accepted those and I understood that. And that was part of the conversation I had with Rennie before I went down there, you know, that, you know, sometimes I need to control myself, really. I'm enthusiastic for it, but obviously you have to be realistic as well with how much I can actually do, you know. And he was quite receptive to that, and he was quite, I felt he was on the same page as me, so I thought, why not?
Footballers, I think, when they're coming towards retirement or when they do retire, seem to fall into two categories. The ones who never want to hear an alarm clock or never want to have a daily routine ever again, and the others then who love that and want to get into coaching. And you definitely seem to fall into that latter category. Like, from everything you're saying, it's almost like there's an addictiveness to football, to the training, to your own detriment at times, because you would have imagined, and from the outside, that going to Cork at 36, 37, there'd be an understanding all round that you need to treat your body slightly differently to somebody 10 years younger.
Yeah, and I definitely felt that I was spending a lot of energy in the week, and come Friday night maybe I wasn't the kind of the hunger, the appetite wasn't there, because, you know, training was quite tough and things. And kind of come Friday, it was almost like the warm up would start to Friday night, and it was almost like a deep breath and like, okay, let's just get through this. And that's how it shouldn't have been, you know.
And at no stage did you talk to John Caulfield about that?
Didn't really, you know. I mean, John's great, and I got a lot of time for John, but, you know, I don't know if you guys are, he's a bit like, he's an intense man, you know, and he does, his training is a bit much. And again, you know, I felt coming home to my home city, I didn't really want to be, and I've never been the player of my career that, you know, I've never gone to see a manager to say, oh, I'm feeling a little bit tired, or, you know, you play with injuries. I've never gone to a manager and said, oh, you know, I'm feeling my hamstring or anything. Mm. And I always wanted to just get on with it, you know, and you know, if it worked out great, it didn't. And again, it's my fault, you know, that I should have went and seen John and should have recognised the signs. Because like I said, once everything settled and I looked back, the signs were there, you know.
Because I presume when you were leaving Palace, you probably had other options in England as well, I'm sure.
Yeah, I did.
And I'm just wondering if that would have been an issue there as well, in terms of probably the resources available at League of Ireland level, in terms of the testing and everybody in the club being aware of where you are physically. And I guess also, by the sounds of it, it feels as though because you were returning home, maybe you put an extra pressure on yourself as well.
Yeah, exactly. And I felt that I didn't want to be like shortchanging anyone or cutting a corner as well, because I felt that, you know, obviously going into a change room, a lot of those young kids might be looking to me and stuff, you know, and then if I'm cutting corners, I don't want to be... I know it sounds so stupid, like, but I didn't want to be setting a bad example. And, you know, if John was putting on a running session, he'd ask me, do you want to do it? I'd say, yeah, no problem, I'd do it. Because, you know, that's always been my way. You know, I wanted to be leading from the front almost, you know, and doing things correctly. And I felt that I'd be cheating almost if I was cutting corners. But, you know, looking back on it, it was pretty stupid, really, what I did. But once all that settled down, and I kind of ironed out all the problems in my head of what went wrong, I still... said I want to play football, and I still felt I was capable, and obviously with Rennie's relationship that I've had with him already, I think it's possible this year.
I have total empathy with you on that one, totally, because
you've spoken about that before.
Well, the older you get, you feel as though you need to train harder, and you realistically you actually don't. If you manage yourself better and you actually have that conversation with the manager, but there's a reluctancy on a manager to give anyone any sort of, do any favours for a player, feel as though they're doing any favours for a certain player. But sometimes you've got to see what's in front of you. Maybe I would think, certainly as manager, you've got such an experienced player that's done so much, he could contribute in so many different ways, and that is the difficulty. Have you had that conversation then with Alan Reynolds this season?
When I first met him there over Christmas, it was the first thing I said to him, you know, before we discussed anything, you know, I just laid it out and I said, look, this is the situation. And this is what I felt went wrong last year, and I'm not wrong. I know what went, what I kind of didn't do right. And I said, this is it, man. And I need this. And I said, if you're open to that and you're okay with that, I said, then let's, but I don't want to sign a contract, go down there to you and then tell you afterwards. So I said, if you're okay with that, then this conversation can go on. And sure, listen, he was absolutely fantastic. He said, listen, when I find out what you were doing down in Cork, he said, I was really surprised. And he's quite good like that with me, you know. I'm not going to be down in Waterford every day like the rest of the lads and stuff, you know. There's sometimes where I won't be going down, or he'll trust me to do my own bits and pieces at home. Because sometimes, you know, on a down day, I just need to go in the gym and kind of just do a bit of prehab or just some slight, you know, mobility work and things, you know, nothing crazy. So he just said, you can do that up in Cork and there'll be no need for you to come down. So that helps as well. So he was very good. So far, so good. He's been true to his word the last couple of weeks, you know.
What can you contribute then in terms of appearances then this season? Have you got a certain target in your head then for the season, Damien?
I want to pretty much play every game, Kev. But I think that's possible.
Learn some lessons, Damien.
Yeah.
So you know the bit I told you earlier about the stupidity of what I did?
Put that aside then, yeah.
Yeah, no, but I think if my training is altered correctly, you know, and I think that if I manage right, I think I can play a vast majority of the games. Now, obviously, there'll be times where I can't. But I said to Rennie, I said, I don't want to be spending energy Monday to Thursday. And then come Friday night, I've got nothing to give you. I'd rather do nothing Monday to Thursday because, you know, I'm experienced enough as a pro to know what I need. You know, sometimes it's just go on a bike, Kev, for like 20 minutes and spin my legs, get the blood flowing. And that's kind of all you need, you know. And then you go in on a Thursday or a Wednesday before the game and you just get a feel of the ball, just to get your feet moving, to get your sharpness and whatnot, you know. So far, so good. But listen, I wanted to try it and I wanted to go down there because I felt that I could still do it, and I didn't want to kind of quit when I felt I could still do it, you know what I mean?
Because I was wondering when I saw the deal being announced if part of it was the lasting impression that you wanted to leave on people? Because unfortunately for a lot of people, it was probably that game against Bohemians, which was live on television when you scored that, quite frankly, incredible own goal. It was quite a finish from out in the corner. Yeah. And then 4-1 down, taken off at half-time. Like, that's for the longevity of your career and all you'd done, that wasn't what you wanted.
You've got him on to actually try and build him up today here now as well. And you're killing the lad off here.
When you said about that Bohemian game, I was going to go, what Bohemian game? Because that's just erased that from my brain. No, but look, look again, if you can kind of step back and kind of clinically analyse what happened, you know, that was a result of the things that I was doing. But look, man, I've not got an ego, you know. I mean, I don't feel that, like, I owe anybody anything. That game happened and it happened, and I put it behind me, and I dealt with that and I've moved on, and I can't change it. But, you know, that aside, you know, that was, didn't bear any factor into what I was doing.
What do you like that night after that Bulls game? You say you dealt with it. What do you like after a game like that?
Well, there's a reason that happens, I think, as a player, you know, and I think if you're honest enough with yourself, and I'm not talking about excuses, but they're factors, because, you know, in the 20-year career, I've never done anything like that. Honestly, in I must have played 600 or 700 games. I have never scored an own goal like that before in my whole life, ever. Or I ever played a half of football. I might have had a minute where I made a mistake, but I've never had a half of football where that happened. So you kind of do have to step back, and again, not to make excuses, but there were reasons for it. And then you just need to figure out, and if you're honest with yourself, and not kind of paper over it or blame other people or, you know, stick it on someone else's toes, you know, you need to step back and be honest and say, okay, this happened, and why did it happen? And if you can figure out why it happened, then you don't make those mistakes again. And that's basically what I did. I didn't feel sorry for myself. I didn't go home and not sleep. You know, I was quite honest enough to say, you know, took a couple of days and talked to some people that I trust, and, you know, and obviously then when I went away in November for 4 weeks there, I was away and I just kind of really let my mind settle, you know, and you figure out why it happens, and then you kind of, you just move on then, really, because there's nothing that you can do. Otherwise, you end up dragging it around with just the rest of your life, and that's not really going to help anyone, is it?
Yeah, and you say all those hundreds of games where it never happened before, and 20 seasons as a pro, like a very successful career, particularly the times at Hull and Queen's Park Rangers and Ipswich. But you must take enormous pride in those 4 seasons as a first-team regular at Palace in the Premier League in your 30s, when for a lot of players, they might be winding down. But that was the stage of your career, because I guess you'd looked after yourself so well and you put the focus in, you got to live life at the very highest level.
Yeah. And the good thing about it is I got to play at that level. So it's kind of answered the question, because, you know, a lot of people would kind of say to yourself, could I have played at that level? And they may never got the chance to, you know. And, you know, when we went up, I thought there might be a fair chance that I can play at this level. I might not be good enough. But then at least you know. You know, that I wasn't good enough at that level, and you go back to the Championship or you go and do something else with your life. But the satisfaction is knowing that I always thought I could play at that level. And then obviously to get to prove it, so to speak, is satisfying, yes. And it was a great time, and I thoroughly enjoyed it.
I wanted to ask you about Ireland. Obviously, our paths crossed playing within the squad. Nathan asked me before we came in, and he said, did you play alongside Damien? And I said, yeah. Obviously, his research is a lot better than mine, because I think we found out, I don't think we actually did play together, but we're in so many squads together over the years. It certainly seemed that way. So, nine caps, and you look back across your career, you mentioned there 600-700 games across your career that you played. We haven't had too many players that have played to the level that you've got to. So do you look back with any regrets? Do you look back with disappointments along your international career?
Not really, Kev, because you know, when Trapper Tony got the job in 08, I was in his first squad, and those 9 caps were spread across about 9 years, I'd say, or at least, what was it, 2008 to 2014 or 15 when I finished. So that's like 7 years, so that's a cap a year. But I went in, and the unfortunate thing is, in that era, there was you, Donny, Sean St. Ledger, Shazy. It was a proper team, you know, and I knew that I was playing the Championship at the time, and it was just unfortunate that I was wrong around the time where there were some very, very good players who were playing week in, week out at a very, very high level. But I went in and I tried, and unfortunately, by the time all you guys left, I was kind of into my 30s by then. And yes, I was playing in the Premier League, but, you know, for one reason or another, it just didn't really work out. And then I obviously, you know yourself, you had to kind of weigh up. I've only got so much to give every year, and those international trips do take it out of you. Because, you know, leaving some Eastern European country on a Wednesday night at, well, it was usually Saturday, Wednesday night, and you're getting back to Dublin at 4 or 5 in the morning, and then your club wants you in on a Thursday, and you're flying back to the UK, and you know, that takes it out of you. And I felt that as I was going into my 30s, and with how I felt towards the whole thing, that's having 9 caps over 7 or 8 years, wherever it was, and I thought, do I really want to keep going in there now, and would it be worth it? Would I get another chance? And I just felt that, well, obviously I didn't get picked, so it wasn't really me that felt this, I'll be honest with you. But I didn't make a fuss when I didn't get picked, and when I didn't get picked, I just left it, and I just focused on my club career, really.
That's interesting then, that dynamic, because at that stage there was so many conversations around that time as to why you weren't in the squad, because Kieran Clarke was the only other centre-back at the time playing first-team Premier League football, and Martin O'Neill had said that, well, you'd sort of made it clear, unless you were going to be involved, you didn't want to travel. Like, did you have that conversation with Martin O'Neill?
No. Like, which is, you know, when he said that, like, I just thought to myself, I went back over the conversation that we had, and I thought, is there any way that he could have misinterpreted or misunderstood what I was saying? Is there any way that he could walk away from that conversation with that impression? And when I went back over the conversation in my head, there wasn't. I just thought, then he came up and said that, and then obviously I just thought, you know what, man, I don't really, I think it was just before the Euros, or it was, you know, and I thought, you know what, the last thing anyone needs to know is just a big kind of public war, so I just let it slide, really, and I just thought, you know what, he obviously is happy with his, with other people, or other people who are playing ahead of me.
So what was the conversation you had with Martin O'Neill at the time?
I'm not going to go into too many details with it and things like that, but you know, it's not something that I want to drag up again. You know what I mean? Martin's not the job no anymore, and to be honest with you, I'd rather just leave that lie. But the unfortunate thing was, when I was playing regularly, I had 4 Premier League players playing ahead of me for Ireland, and then when I came in later, I was in the Premier League and there was 4 Championship players playing ahead of me. And I couldn't get my head around that. I just thought I was pretty unfortunate, but look, it is what it is, man. I'm not going to dwell on this, and I did the best I possibly could, and I went in there for 7 or 8 years, every trip, you know, every away trip and everything, and you know, kind of got a cap in the June friendlies when all those lads had kind of left the squad and that type of thing, and I did the best I could. It's just the timing was slightly wasn't right, you know.
Yeah, and the way you talk there about the benefits it had, I guess, not being involved in the squad and not having those long trips probably helped your longevity.
No question.
But were you able to see it like that at the time, or was there that desperation, which we hear from so many, from Kevin and so many of the former internationals, to push themselves for an Ireland team, to get over there as much as possible? At the time, was it something that was deeply frustrating?
No, not really, because I mean, you know, when Martin had taken over, it was different, and I felt that maybe, you know, I probably wouldn't have played that much anyway. Possibly, I don't know. I don't know what the situation was, but it wasn't something that I was willing to push. And I tell you, when you're playing regularly and you're older, and those international breaks come around in August, September, and October, they're a godsend, you know, to get a weekend off. And the manager gives you 4 or 5 days, and you might go to Spain or somewhere and get a bit of sun on your back, and you come back rejuvenated. You know, that kind of gets you to November in the season, and then you just got to get the head down over Christmas, and before you know it, you get another one in February or March if there's internationals, you know. So they are kind of a godsend, really. And the way it worked out, that it kept me fresh and kept me healthy, really.
We don't need to go over the old ground of yourself and Roy Keane, because I think everybody knows about it. And Roy even wrote about it in his autobiography that he felt he was probably a little bit too hard with you at times at Ipswich.
Yeah. But could you imagine that? Could you imagine that as well? If Roy's admitting that.
Well, exactly. I guess that's the thing. The very fact that he was admitting it probably just gives a bit of an... Like, your memory of that time as to how hard he was on you. Did you feel you were being singled out?
I don't feel I was being singled out, but I felt he was very, very hard on me. But again, the way I justify that to myself in Ipswich is he picked me every week. And that is the ultimate compliment the manager can give you. So he might have been at me every day and every game. But like, other players came and went out of the club, and other players didn't play, and other players were sold and whatever. But the ultimate compliment is the manager picking you.
But can you play your best? Can you play your best football if there's that type of atmosphere? I guess that, like, that's the question even surrounding the Ireland team of the last few years, whereby it seems like a very old school attitude.
Yeah, not really. I mean, it's difficult, you know. But again, I just kind of, you know, I got my head down and tried not to make eye contact with him, to be honest with you. And usually he left me alone, but, you know, when he did go, he'd go at you. But then he'd pick me the following week, so I just thought, well, what are you complaining about? Just, you know, just do what you can.
Yeah. Like that's remarkable that you're going. Yeah. And maybe it's not that remarkable. I don't know, Kev, you've been in dressing rooms as well, that players will go around trying to avoid the manager almost.
Yeah, not so much. Probably in the last 10 years, I would say that maybe the last 10, maybe 20 years ago, I suppose that type of environment was a little bit more commonplace, and not so much over the last 10 years. I think there was more of an acceptance that maybe the game had evolved. I think players mentally were more aware of the surroundings and had to. And we're doing things differently than they would have done. I'm talking mindful of the body, mindful of everything around the game, and that was certainly a huge change within the game. So that was a rarity, I think, certainly a rarity within the modern game, without a doubt. Yeah.
Can I just clarify there that I didn't ever avoid him? That was just a kind of figure of speech, right. You know what I mean? You know, if I made a mistake, came in at half time, I probably would head towards the physio room. And try not be in the roof. that type of thing.
Do you think in hindsight that the issues around the time at Ipswich did play a part in what happened with Ireland?
No, not really. Roy was the assistant and Martin was the manager, so not really. You know, the first squad I went into, Roy was absolutely fine with me. You know, I had a conversation and just a general chit chat, not about anything. Like, you know, we talked about a couple of things at Ipswich, you know what happened and whatever, but nothing, you know, about anything in depth, and Roy was absolutely fine with me, and I probably spoke more with him in a couple of squads that I was in than I did in the whole time I was at Ipswich with him, and that's probably the truth.
I want to ask you about Palace, and one game actually in particular, because it's a game I was commentating on and stands out above any other really of the last 5-6 years, was the night of the 3-3 draw with Liverpool. For all the games I've ever been to, I do not remember an atmosphere quite like Selhurst Park that night when you were 3-0 down. And remember, Liverpool had just been beaten by Chelsea the week before, and they needed, if they'd won that game 8 or 9-0, they could have closed the goal difference gap in City. Nobody thought it would happen, and they found themselves 3-0 up earlier, and they could have actually found themselves 7 or 8-0 up. You kept it at 3-0, and you scored this brilliant goal with 12 minutes left, and you scored three goals in the space of 9 minutes.
Yeah.
3-3, Steven Gerrard, Luis Suarez are in tears, and the place was literally hopping. The ground was shaking underneath us. What's your memory of that night?
Just what you said there, really. You know, I mean, the first 78 minutes was an absolute catastrophe. Like, you know, we couldn't do anything right. And remember, Tony, it was the first time Tony Pulis really, you know, showed his teeth at us at half time. You know, we were well safe by then. You know, I think we were guaranteed top half as well. I think we were 9th or 10th at the time. And I think maybe the first 78 minutes we played a little bit like that. But the players that we had there at the time, their attitudes and their kind of just willingness just to keep going in the face of anything, that's what we kind of had. And obviously when that goal went in, it just kind of, and the crowd then was just, you know, fantastic. Because, you know, 3-0 at home, it was quite easy for some people to head off. It was a Monday night game. Getting away from Selhurst isn't the easiest thing in the world. A lot of people could have might have made their way away, you know, but they didn't. They stayed and the drums were still going. And it was such a packed atmosphere, even though we were losing 3-0. And then obviously when that goal goes in, and then Gailey got two, so I mean it was a fantastic night, and it's definitely one that I'll remember for the rest of my life, really.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone remembers the pictures, I think, of Gerrard and Suarez walking off. Do you remember what it was like in the dressing room afterwards?
Yeah, it was just absolute jubilation, to be honest. We were just, you know, we were buzzing. But if I'm being honest, I was still just thinking about the first 78 minutes, really. I was just thinking, I don't want to do that again next week, but I think we had one game left after that or whatever, and like I said, my memories of that night really is at half-time. Tony Pulis, when he cut loose at me and Scott Dan, because, oh my God, and that wasn't a pretty sight, really, because he'd never really done it before, but him in full flow is in a pretty picture.
What did he say? What did he say to you, Damien?
Oh, just absolutely everything, you know, just like you think you're on your, you know, the usual ones, you think you're on your holidays, you've checked out already, you know, if you think that, or, you know, except that you won't be here next year, and this isn't good enough, and we're too excellent thrown in and stuff like that as well. But he was quite ferocious in his delivery.
It seems like a great place to play, Palace.
Yeah, yeah. Listen, you know, the club went from administration to the Premier League in the space of a couple of years, you know, so definitely the first 3 or 4 years, it was such a great, we can't believe we're here from the fans, you know what I mean? Because they went from, like, almost being relegated out of the Championship a couple of years beforehand to being in the Premier League. So, like, there definitely was that. Like, I mean, every away game, every home game, nobody ever left because it was such, like, it was just a continuous high. And even when we lost, no one got upset. The fans were still, like, so thankful and grateful that, like, you know, they were even having, even if we got relegated, because they were all expecting just to get relegated straight away the following season. And then the second season, they were even, like, going up, second season syndrome, you'll be gone again. And then we stayed up again. And it was just this continuous good buzz and good feel, and everything was fantastic around the club. And that was my thing, that we could do no wrong as players, even when we got bashed by anyone or things didn't go well. The fans never, ever, ever questioned us. There was just still this amazing kind of feeling towards us. And obviously, you know, times change and expectations change when you're Premier League for 5 years. Now they expect a little bit more, and it goes the way it normally does, you know.
Yeah. What is your best memory from that time at Palace? Because you played around about 170 games for Palace in the end.
Yeah.
It was an amazing time for you towards the back end of your career as well, but you become such a mainstay. I mean, maybe playing under Pulis, and I know how Tony Pulis plays. It was quite rigid as a back four, but the job that you were doing was such a key job for the side within there.
Yeah.
And then, when you became a little bit more open and expansive, you were still a mainstay of that side. So playing under different managers, different styles, different systems, what was your abiding memory from your time there?
I think my abiding memory, like, it's probably, I thought something silly, but like we won at Chelsea 2-1, and you know how hard it is to go to a top four side and win. You know, I mean, they don't lose games at home very often, and we had so many goals against top four teams, and we could never beat them. And it was always thing. And then I think it was the season Mourinho got fired over that whole doctor thing. We went there quite early in the season. We turned them over 2-1, and they were champions as well at the time. So, like, that for me was just like, you know, Everest. You know, for it was just to win at a top four. That was always on my bucket list. I wanted to win away at a top four team. You know, because, you know, I think someone said Mourinho's record at the time is he'd only lost a handful of games in 10 years at home in the league, you know, but through the Inter Milan and Real and all that.
Yeah.
So that's how difficult that was. And I think that was, that Chelsea away game for me was a massive one, because the enormous sense of achievement after that.
I think that was the second time Mourinho had lost a home league game in 100 league games in charge of Chelsea.
Was he? It's great knowledge. So,
but it was something like that. I remember the time someone gave me a star after the game, and, like, you know, mentally, physically, and emotionally, you have to give so much to win at a top four. I'm sure even if you ask Kev now, you know, in all the games he played at,
very few.
Chelsea, there's probably not. I mean, there might be, but I'm guessing there's not many. Kev, no.
I won at Chelsea once, actually. I did manage to win at Chelsea when I was at Sunderland, yeah. But there are very few against the top four sides. He's right in that, particularly that Mourinho side and the Chelsea.
Yeah,
no chance.
Yeah. So that was probably it for me, because that was always on top of my list of things to achieve, really. Obviously, winning a trophy is always up there, but that would probably be my abiding one, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I thought you might have gone for the cup final.
Yeah.
With Palace. I suppose when you lose it, maybe it's not the right memory. And But what about Alan Pardew's little dance when Punchin scored the goal?
Yeah, I did. It was 2 days later when I found out about that, to be honest with you. So, by then, I just didn't really care. It was all days and I was away, so... it was 12 minutes away from winning the FA Cup, or 10 minutes, whatever it was, when Punch scored. So that was pretty close. I mean, that would have been obviously the ultimate, but it wasn't to be.
Before we let you go, we must ask about the Roma connection. So if anybody doesn't know, this is the Roma's official club account. When you were leaving Crystal Palace to sign for Cork, they put up a tweet saying hashtag Grazie Damien, and they've had lots of different tweets since then. What is the connection with Roma?
Just in the interest of keeping it going, I'm not going to tell you.
brilliant.
I get asked about that a lot, actually. You know, and I keep that between me and Roma, to be honest with you.
You don't know, do you?
No, I have no idea, man.
Well, we look forward to see what happens next. Did you get a tweet when you signed for Waterford?
Yeah, they did. Did
wow.
It actually, yeah. They, I didn't see it now, but someone said to me they put up a link to something to do with Waterford's history of, like, over the last 50 years or something, and said that Waterford is their new favourite city in Ireland or something
class.
Like that. I only briefly saw it, to be honest. But yeah, I think they did something, yeah.
That's brilliant. Damien, great stuff. By the sounds of it, you're going to be involved in football for a long time to come. I'd imagine there's coaching roles in your future.
That I don't know now, to be honest. Yeah, I'd have to rethink about that. I like playing football. Coaching, I'm not really Undecided yet, to be honest with you. You know, I like Killer's job there. You know,
yeah, come in here
anytime.
Yeah,
we'll happily exchange him. Yes, he's losing touch with the modern game, Damien.
It's all right. No worries.
You're always welcome, Damien, in studio. Thanks a lot for taking the call.
Thanks, Kev. Thanks.